To this afternoon's panel and discussion. We're delighted to see so many people here and delighted to have this opportunity to discuss one of the most important issues in the city right now. My name is Ken Guest. I'm an anthropologist. I teach at Baruch College and I'll be your moderator for today. It's our pleasure to have a panel today talking about the politics of gentrification, investment, displacement, and the fight for the future in Chinatown and in Greenpoint. Greenpoint Williamsburg for all of that. We want to say thank you to some folks in particular, Roosevelt House, for welcoming us and hosting us, Jack Rosenthal, for your support and for getting out these fantastic policy briefings that have put some of this out in the public sphere. So thank you very much for having us. Thank you to our co-sponsors, the Anthropology Department at Hunter College, Sociology Department, Urban Planning, the Mapping of Asian American New York Research Collective. I think any other people we need to thank formally. Thank you all. I haven't thanked you. Thank you. I was thinking about, in terms of framing our conversation today, that in the mayor's State of the City address in February, he spent a lot of time talking about housing. And he said, nothing more expresses the inequality gap, the opportunity gap, than the soaring cost of housing. Without a change in housing policy, he said, New York risks taking on the qualities of a gated community, a place defined by exclusivity rather than opportunity. So I think he said something important there. What he does about it will be another question. And that's part of what we're going to be exploring today. We have panelists who have focused on Greenpoint and Williamsburg, folks who focused on Chinatown, two areas in New York City which are really contested terrains, where this battle over housing, what kind of housing, affordability, issues of gentrification are really front and center, and which I think can serve as exciting case studies, opportunities to explore the history, the current dynamics, the elements that are going into the contestation, what does gentrification look like, how is it being contested, what kind of future conversations and actions do we need to think about as we engage this process that's going on in the city. So we're delighted to have with us two younger scholars, Sam Stein, who's an urban geographer, and Sam specializes in issues of labor and housing in New York City. He's been doing a lot of work in Chinatown, especially around the zoning, the gentrification process, following the Chinatown Working Group process very closely. And we also have Philip Dabrowski, who has his PhD in geography, also from UC Berkeley. His dissertation was Housing Polish Greenpoint, Poverty and Power in a Gentrifying Brooklyn Neighborhood. And Philip's teaching as an adjunct now at Hunter College in the Anthro Department. So these two are going to be presenting some of their research, their real wonderful and rich ethnographic work. And then we have two amazing and distinguished scholar activists with us. Peter Kwong is a distinguished professor of urban affairs and planning at Hunter College, also on the sociology faculty at the Grad Center. He was on my dissertation committee, and so thank you, Peter, for letting me graduate. one of the leading scholars on Chinese American studies and politics and labor issues, with lots of books. You should read all of them. Ida Susser, who's chair of the Anthro Department at Hunter and on the Graduate Center faculty, with incredible wide-ranging research in and activism in areas of globalization and health and migration and inequality. And I think it was your dissertation turned into a book, was this fantastic piece called Norman Street, which is just reissued with an intro that everybody should read, which really frames our conversation about the restructuring of New York City in the last 20 years as we think about New York as a global city, as the financial services and how it's being rebuilt to serve that, and its impact on Greenpoint Williamsburg, and then we'll connect that to Chinatown as well. Margaret Chin is professor of sociology at Hunter and also at the Grad Center, and has been very active in community-based research in Chinatown, founding member of our Mapping Asian American New York collective, and author of Sewing Women, Immigrants and New York City's Garment Industry. So it's a fantastic panel, and I'm going to get out of the way. And is there anything else I should say to start? We're going to let, did you guys flip a coin?
Didn't. No, that's up to you. You want to go?
Sure, I'll go ahead.
Sam lost, so he's going first. Sam Stein, thank you very much for joining us. Talk to us a little bit about
it. Thank you for that introduction. Thank you all for being here. Thank you to the Roosevelt House for hosting us. Peter Kwong and I wrote the Roosevelt House issue brief entitled Preserve and Protect Chinatown, which I believe there are copies of available in the back. Yesterday, an article entitled Chinatown Comes Into Its Own appeared in the real estate newspaper The Real Deal. So this is how it starts. Located at the intersection of Tribeca, Soho, Little Italy, and Lower East Side, and boasting easy access to Brooklyn, Chinatown appears to be in a prime spot for luxury development. But the neighborhood remains home to low-rise housing and independently owned Asian businesses. Quote, developers are pushing into the boundaries a bit and encroaching into Chinatown territory, said Conquering Group's Julia Pham. Again, Julia says, I think it's a corridor that's going to change probably very rapidly over the next 5 to 10 years. It is in a very central location, and it's just a matter of time before that real estate appreciates and buyers find that area desirable. Now, if you read our issue brief, it starts off from pretty much the same place, but hoping that it goes in the exact opposite direction. So there's a general agreement that the time and place of Chinatown right now is a real crucible, and that gentrification and speculative luxury development could very well sweep into the neighborhood the way it has in its surroundings. The questions that Dr. Kwong and I are asking are, why hasn't Chinatown gentrified already, like all of its neighbors? And why is Chinatown suddenly going through something that looks like a very quick gentrification? So first, why is Chinatown exceptional? For decades, it's featured a constant stream of new immigrants from all over Eastern China and elsewhere. It was the only expanding working class, people of color neighborhood in Manhattan during the 1990s and early 2000s. As others were being pushed in, Chinatown was expanding into areas like the Lower East Side and Little Italy. As a result, there's not a lot of vacancy there, either closed up businesses, vacant apartments, or vacant lots. And Dr. Kwong is going to talk more about the economic model that has surfaced in Chinatown, but it's really done a pretty good job of at least creating a lot of employment opportunity and housing, housing people, new immigrants. So in order to understand why Chinatown moved from being an exception to a target of gentrification, we have to very quickly understand what exactly gentrification is. We could spend hours on this, so let's just go with the simplest definitions. Gentrification is the process of reinvestment in disinvested urban spaces. It's the replacement of poorer and usually darker people with richer and usually whiter inhabitants. It's a strategy for extracting profit from the city's raw materials, i.e. its land and buildings. And it's a political reorganization of cities from a Keynesian model to a neoliberal. Gentrification is all of those things and many other things too. And in the classic mode, gentrification happens opportunistically. It needs places with a high quality housing stock that have undergone a period of disinvestment and abandonment. Investors and entrepreneurs recognize a rent gap between how much housing costs and how much it could cost if some simple things were done, like renovating the building, changing from a rooming house to single occupancy, changing the zoning, etc. The thing about 21st century Chinatown is that those opportunities largely don't exist. Once again, there's not a lot of vacancy, so it has to be created. The opportunities have to be created, the space has to be created. How is that done? Short version is by evicting families, by denying commercial leases, by tearing down buildings. All of this takes massive, concentrated investment, as well as public action by the state. So I'm going to go through a few of the strategies for making that happen, for creating the opportunity for gentrification to take place. They could be categorized as four sets of action strategies. First is real estate and housing. The second is commercial and retail. The third is nonprofit and public-private partnerships. And the fourth is planning and zoning. I'm going to go through all of them briefly, but really focus on that fourth one, planning and zoning. So first, real estate and housing. So like I said, the rent gap that exists between where the rents are right now and where they could be, it can't easily be closed in Chinatown. It's important to remember this because the way that the building stock is, it's mostly rent stabilized, some rent controlled, a lot of public housing in Section 8. You can't just raise the rents to what the markets will bear. You have to either do enough harassment of tenants to get them out of their apartments and then take action to deregulate the apartments, or you have to find the loopholes in the rent laws and exploit them. Both of those things are happening at a very rapid rate in Chinatown. There's a high level of conversion and construction of new residential buildings, almost all of which are completely alien to and exclusionary of the neighborhood's current residents. Just the rents are nowhere near what people can afford. This gentrification is market-driven, like all gentrification, but it's enabled by government complicity and inaction. In almost all the cases, there are laws that protect tenants. They're just simply not enforced. The resistance on this front is pretty steady. There are tenant organizations in rent-stabilized buildings, in public housing, in SROs that are fighting back, but it's a very tough battle. So that's real estate. The next one is commercial and retail strategies. Commercial turnover is the most visible and the most vulnerable element in gentrification. It's visible because you can just see that it happened. This used to be a cheap restaurant, now it's an expensive restaurant. This used to be a cheap tailor shop, now it's a boutique clothing store. But it really only happens after the residential turnover has taken place because they need the base of customers that's already there to spend all that money. So when you see that happening, the gentrification has really already happened. I said that it's the most vulnerable because while there are rent stabilization and other laws to protect tenants, there's nearly nothing to protect commercial businesses from rent skyrocketing. The two manifestations that Dr. Kwong and I talk about of this commercial gentrification are a boom in hotels. There's now about 35 in Chinatown, whereas there were about 5 maybe 10 years ago. And a boom in art galleries, which is an interesting one. We believe, observing over the last 5 years or so, that the art galleries are a strategy to convert a street that is not really about making money off of art galleries, it's about changing the psychology of how people with money think of Chinatown. That it's no longer the place where cheap things that I don't go to are, it's the place where I go and look at art. And then after the art gallery's lease expires, they're very often kicked out very quickly and replaced by a bar, a boutique clothing store, something that sells things at a much higher rate and commands a higher rent. So then we have the nonprofit and public-private strategies. Nonprofit organizations are the leading power brokers at this point in Chinatown and a key bridge between outside business and government and the local population. From nonprofit housing corporations like Asian Americans for Equality to cultural institutions like the Lower East Side Tenement Museum, nonprofits are taking the lead in framing the neighborhood as a project to be completed or a problem to be fixed, and then attracting the capital to do so. So in essence, they're negotiating Chinatown's gentrification on behalf of its residents. The most important project to come out of that nexus of nonprofits is the Business Improvement District, or BID. BIDs are a sort of self-taxing unit where they raise money from each property and then put it towards extra street cleaning, extra security, extra street fairs, etc. The problem is BIDs raise the cost of doing business, and in Chinatown, the economic model is a very small profit margin. So if you decline that, you could very easily send a business out of business. Also, it raises property values. Usually landlords love raise property values, but if your model is multi-generational ownership of a building, your biggest concern on a day-to-day level is property taxes. If the property values rise, that's not necessarily good for you. And you're more likely then to sell the building because you can't afford the taxes. And the person who buys it is probably going to be a speculator who's not going to keep it as affordable as it was. And then finally, it pushes the neighborhood towards tourism, which has always been a small part of the Chinatown economy, but is becoming a larger and larger fixture and has less and less to do with the local population and the local economy. There was a great deal of resistance to the bid. It was the closest vote of any bid in city history. And there's an attempt now to undo it, that property owners are getting signatures on the petition. It's a very difficult process, but they're trying to do it. So finally, planning and zoning, which is in some ways the heart of the matter. Planning and zoning matter because it sets up the shape of the neighborhood for the future. It defines how big the buildings can be, what can go where, but it also creates a great amount of wealth instantaneously. If you've got a lot that's allowed to be 5 stories and suddenly you allow it to be 30 stories, you've given the owner of that land an enormous profit if they decide to sell that land. So you might be expecting me now to say that Chinatown was rezoned and that's a problem. The truth is Chinatown was not rezoned and the neighborhood just north of it was, and that's where the problem lies. So in 2008, East Village, Lower East Side rezoning covered 111 blocks, so it was the third largest rezoning since the entire city was zoned in 1961. And it came in the context of the East Village and Lower East Side being gentrified, having higher property values, and also seeing a lot of out-of-scale development coming up. The building owners and tenants in the East Village wanted to stop that, and they managed to get a contextual rezoning. A rezoning that says, basically, things should stay at the height and bulk level that they are right now. This was supported by certain nonprofits in Chinatown who said, you know, fine, and they got out of it the ability to build inclusionary developments on some key Chinatown avenues, like Christie Street, for example, and Avenue D. They can build bigger apartments if they include some degree of below market rate housing in them. But a large number of Chinatown organizations really vigorously opposed this, and they called it a racist rezoning. So where does that come from? The zoning action protected 73% of the white residents of the community board and just 23% of the Asians. So not coincidentally, it also covered the richest census blocks in the community board. The affordable housing that would be created would be completely unaffordable to the Chinatown working class community. And most importantly, by protecting one side of the neighborhood but not the other, it would send the pressure to develop big luxury buildings southward. And that's exactly what we've seen since 2008. It was passed unanimously by the city council in 2008. 3 years later, there was another rezoning, the Seward Park Urban Renewal Area. This is a very long story that I'd be happy to get into in question and answer. The short version is, in 1967, 14 blocks of the Lower East Side in Chinatown were demolished, 2,000 families were displaced, and for almost 50 years, next to nothing was built on the land. Spurrow was left out of the 2008 rezoning because it was thought to be too controversial, so it was brought up later. The folks who opposed that initial rezoning said, this is public land, these were poor people who were displaced, we should put 100% affordable housing on this land. They even found a developer who was willing to do it, but what ended up happening was the more typical mix that we get in New York City zoning right now. So it's 1,000 new apartments, whereas, as I said, 2,000 people were displaced. 20% of them would be low income, 20% middle income, 10% senior. The rest is market rate. So at market rates, 1% of Chinatown can afford to live in half of this development. Just, I think it's 14% can afford to live in the so-called affordable portion. So what's being built in this area is very much not for the people who most need housing in Chinatown. So to deal with the exclusion of Chinatown from the 2008 rezoning, the city set up something called the Chinatown Working Group, which brought together community boards 1, 2, and 3, which each contain part of Chinatown, and a number of neighborhood stakeholders. There's now 47 organizations as of last year that can vote in this body. And it's landlords, it's tenants, it's developers, it's worker centers. It's just about as broad a swath of not only the neighborhood, but political ideologies as you could get in a room. They've spent about 7 years coming up with a community plan for Chinatown. And what they came up with is basically a special district for Chinatown. There are a number of these in the cities. Special districts can have much more intensive zoning protections than regular zoned areas. There would be an anti-eviction and anti-harassment provision for the entire area. Any inclusionary zoning that happens would be in very targeted places where the buildings are already taller. And the affordability rates would be tacked to the local area, and it would be up to 55% affordable in these buildings. There would be restrictions on big box stores and hotels, and more allowances for light manufacturing. This is really pretty close to what activists were demanding in 2008. Community Board 3 has been passing pieces of the plan and wants to move towards passing the whole thing, which would eventually make it official. Last month, however, the New York City Department of City Planning Director Carl Weisbrod wrote a letter to the community board stating that they have no intention to adopt the plan. They said it's too ambitious, it's too big. They said that they're interested in the parts about development, but not so much the parts about preservation. So the Chinatown Working Group is currently figuring out how to respond, reorganizing, but it's a very fragile coalition, and so this kind of thing is a big blow, and I think it is something worth keeping in mind as we think about the differences between Bloomberg and de Blasio and to what extent they matter and what we can do about it. So our issue brief ended with 3 very modest policy proposals that we think would make a big difference. One is to actually create this special district in Chinatown. A second is to reject inclusionary zoning as the main tool for developing housing or low-income housing. We think that it will make gentrification happen a lot faster than it will slow it down. And then finally, to dismantle the business improvement district. Those are our recommendations. There's a lot more that needs to be done, but those are some city-level policy things that could have a dramatic impact on whether or not Chinatown gentrifies the way its neighbors have. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you so much, Sam, and I think we'll come back around to talking about some more some of the additional dynamics of the local economy, which are working to keep Chinatown's ethnic economy going. But let's turn now to Philip and hear about Greenpoint Williamsburg.
I'm just going to set up the images quickly.
So thank you, Ken, and thank you, everyone, for coming today. I think this is a conversation that I'm excited about. I think it's an important conversation. It's one that, in a way, I've been having sort of informally with Peter, at least for a while, and it's nice to be able to sort of share it and talk more collectively about these issues, because they are pressing, I think. So I'm going to be talking about Greenpoint in Williamsburg, drawing upon the issue brief that Professor Susser and I wrote for this series, and see if we could sort of draw some comparisons with Chinatown and sort of the city at large. So this May, exactly 10 years ago actually this May, the New York City Council voted almost unanimously to approve the rezoning of the East River waterfront in Greenpoint in Williamsburg in North Brooklyn. Now, anybody who's been to those neighborhoods recently, particularly the north side of Williamsburg and Bedford Avenue, would probably have a hard time recognizing the neighborhood. It's changed so drastically, and the impact of that rezoning decision was so profound, and it's most noticeable probably in that north side of Williamsburg, but if you go up into Greenpoint, even though the waterfront might not look so different, that's changing, and it will change with increasing intensity in the next several years. I think that it's an opportune time to reflect and reconsider this rezoning decision, and I think so for a couple of reasons. First, the rezoning itself was a significant part of the Bloomberg city planning land use policy and housing development policy legacy. I think thinking about then this particular rezoning decision, which was the largest during the Bloomberg era, and at the time the largest in the history of New York City, is a way to reflect upon the Bloomberg approach to planning instead of zoning, as the planner or the urban planner Tom Angotti has said. And secondly, reconsidering and reflecting upon this rezoning decision is a way to look forward to the future, to consider some lessons possibly for the current administration, which has its own plans for rezoning the city, tied to its own housing plan to build or preserve 200,000 units of affordable housing, which is even more ambitious than the Bloomberg plan. As Sam mentioned, to what extent these plans differ is something that we can discuss, but it's an interesting question, and I think looking back on the experience of Greenpoint and Williamsburg following the rezoning is a way to sort of consider some of these questions. So what I want to do today, drawing upon this issue brief, is to talk, to start by talking a little bit about the background, some of the history pertaining to the rezoning decision in 2005, and then go into some of the effects, both sort of immediate and then longer term over the past decade in the communities of Williamsburg and Greenpoint, which historically have been mixed ethnic, working class, and immigrant communities. And then finally, to consider some of the lessons learned and offer some future policy recommendations for rezonings that sort of await us, undoubtedly. So, first, starting with the history and the background of this rezoning decision. I think the first thing to keep in mind is that this, in some ways, was not a new conversation or discussion, the rezoning itself. The city had been eyeing the waterfront, discussing plans for the waterfront for several years, decades even. There had been plans that had been put forward in the 70s, again in the 90s. But more importantly, perhaps, there was two particular plans that were actually formulated by residents and community organizations in Greenpoint and Williamsburg, the so-called 197A plans. And these plans were formed through a long process of deliberation, consultation, argumentation, all of that. A 12-year process, in fact, that occurred roughly between 1989 and 2000. This plan was finally certified in 2001. But what's important, I think, to keep in mind is these plans emerged from a community that had mobilized around a specific set of issues having to do with deindustrialization, how it took place on the North Brooklyn waterfront. Industry had been replaced by a whole sort of wide array of various toxic and waste-related facilities in that area, which to this day remain. And the community sort of mobilized around these issues, and in the process eventually came up with their own set of recommendations for how they would like to see their waterfront change and how they would like to, in some ways, gain access to a waterfront that had been technically, legally off limits, although in practice perhaps more accessible than it is now, interestingly. And so out of this process came a set of recommendations that essentially called for the preservation of viable industry, contextual development, the creation of affordable housing, that is housing affordable to locals living in the area, and of course access to the waterfront, public access to the waterfront, most importantly. Now, what eventually sort of transpired, the decision and the content of the rezoning proposal that the city put forth in 2003 bore little or no resemblance to the plans as put forward by the community, the 197A plans. In fact, the plan wasn't really a plan, it was a decision to do a blanket rezoning of roughly 175 blocks along the waterfront and a little bit upland, converting or transforming with the stroke of a pen, the land use to from industrial to mixed use and residential, and increasing the density, particularly on the waterfront, to enable the construction of 40, 60-story towers, depending on the developer's options, as well as a privately funded esplanade on the waterfront, which would be given over to public access, supposedly, and no provisions for any kind of affordable housing or industrial retention. Now, in the process of sort of negotiation and opposition, the community board, Brooklyn Community Board number one, actually rejected the rezoning proposal. But in the process of negotiation, there were a number of terms of agreement that were drawn up, that were added as addenda to the actual zoning agreement. There were demands made by community groups, a coalition called the North Brooklyn Alliance, that called for 40% mandatory affordable housing in addition to a industrial retention fund. And eventually, the text of the rezoning agreement that was passed in 2005 included a $2 million industrial retention fund, a $2 million tenant anti-harassment fund, a tenant anti-harassment zone along the lines of the Clinton Special District, which Sam was talking about with respect to Chinatown, as well as, importantly, a so-called inclusionary housing program. This was sort of dusted off. This program existed before, but was modified and brought out in 2005, specifically for the Greenpoint Waynesburg waterfront. Now, the key features of this inclusionary housing program were the following: that it was voluntary, it was not mandatory, that it called only for 20% affordable housing, that the affordability levels were also questionable. There was the option to either provide 20 low income or 25 percent of a mixture of low and moderate income. Of course, the affordability levels, as in Chinatown, did not match the actual income levels in the neighborhoods, nor in most of New York City for that matter. And also importantly, there was the possibility for developers to be able to sort of double dip, as it were, to combine density bonuses, which was part of the inclusionary housing program, with tax subsidies or abatement programs like the 421A tax abatement program. So nevertheless, this inclusionary housing program was spoken about with much fanfare. It was lauded and hailed as a historic opportunity. Sean Donovan, who was the commissioner of HPD at the time, went on to bigger and better things at HUD, referred to it famously as a mechanism to harness the power of the New York City market, real estate marketplace, to generate affordable housing. He saw this in historic terms as a way to do what people thought was impossible, that is, produce affordable housing in a market that was as hot as New York's market. It was anticipated at the time, and this is again in the text of the actual terms of agreement, that the anticipated affordable housing that would emerge, over 3,500 units, which would constitute, when all was said and done, 33% of the total units developed along the waterfront and upland as well, which it was argued was far higher even than the 20% that the inclusionary housing program mandated. Ultimately, the rezoning agreement passed. Community groups sort of made their peace with it to a greater or lesser extent. The residents obviously looked forward to anything that would give them access to the waterfront. And there was some funding available for tenant groups to do organizing to try to do anti-displacement work. So what were the effects of this rezoning? Okay, I mean, here I think it's important to actually state, say, that the effects of the rezoning actually predated the rezoning itself, if that makes any sense. Just the consideration, the serious consideration given to rezoning actually created a speculative environment in which landlords were, particularly along the waterfront, commercial and industrial landlords, raised rents, refused to renew leases for viable industries. Residential landlords were also pushing out tenants even before the rezoning agreement had the ink had dried on the actual agreement itself. So there were significant effects even before the rezoning in anticipation of it. But secondly, and sort of beyond the actual agreement itself, or after the actual agreement itself, we can look at some sort of hard numbers, which thankfully some other groups have actually conducted or uncovered. In a 2013 study by the office of City Council member Brad Lander, it was which studied actually inclusionary housing throughout the city, it came to light that only 949 or 13% of the over 7,200 units that had been produced since the rezoning were part of the inclusionary housing program. So that was 13% of the entire number of units produced. Now 30% of these units were not even new units, they were actually preserved units. That was another option that the inclusionary housing program provided. And this, ironically, was actually one of the great success stories of the inclusionary housing program throughout the city in Greenpoint and Williamsburg. The other success story was the west side of Manhattan. The affordable housing that was produced, perhaps unsurprisingly, was not affordable to most of the residents that were most in need of this housing. Particularly in Community Board 1, there are a number of low-income residents on public assistance, seniors on fixed incomes. They were not able to afford or even qualify for apartments in the new affordable housing developments. So the first big one that went up, it's called The Edge, something like 340 units that were up for affordable housing lottery. And the only low-income local residents that were able to qualify for housing in The Edge were those that had portable Section 8 vouchers. Of course, anybody who knows the Section 8 system now knows that those are impossible to come by. There's a backlog of Section 8, and the city has very little leverage with respect to the Section 8 program, at least in this context. Now, some data that we actually discussed in the issue brief regarding affordable housing and the desperate need for affordable housing in these communities came from the $2 million, the tenant services contract that was funded by the $2 million tenant services fund, remember, as part of the terms of agreement with the rezoning. And this contract was a two-year contract from 2008 to 2010. And over those 2 years, there were over 5,000 office visits or phone calls from residents in need of assistance in locating or applying for affordable housing. There were more recently, there was a affordable housing lottery just late last year for 105 units in North Greenpoint. And North Greenpoint is hardly the epicenter of what perhaps it's becoming, but has hardly been the epicenter of gentrification. Still, for those 105 units, there were over nearly 60,000 applications for 105 units of affordable housing. Now, this is something that I think many lotteries are confronted with now. And of course, 60% of these units were for households that were earning between $70,000 and $140,000 a year, which is far higher than low-income households in throughout the city. Another effect, of course, is that rents continue to skyrocket in the neighborhoods. Rent increases, median market rent has gone up by 82% from 2002 to 2011, which is higher than Brooklyn as a whole, even higher than Manhattan. And the median rent burden for low-income tenants has increased from 38.7% to 46.5%. That is, 46.5% of low-income tenants' income is going towards rent. Now, any rent burden over 30% is considered to be a rent burden. So this is almost approaching 50%, which is a severe rent burden. At the same time, of course, the incentives for landlords to take units out of rent regulation through apartment renovations, through illegal evictions, that continues to take its toll on residents in the neighborhood. And more recently, there's been a proliferation of illegal short-term hotel stays, popularly known as Airbnb because it's the most popular service out there. It's concentrated in, among other gentrifying or gentrified neighborhoods, in the north side of Williamsburg and in Greenpoint. This has not only decreased the safety and quality of life of neighbors and building residents, but has also provided incentives for landlords to remove units from the long-term rental market, again, driving rents up even further. Another effect has been landlord harassment. Tenant organizers have been confronting this on a daily basis, different methods, harassing tenants verbally, refusing to provide building services, pressuring tenants to leave or to accept buyouts. There's actually an anti-buyout campaign in Bushwick, which is sort of drawing from this experience, refusing to renew leases, and sometimes even, increasingly, landlords destroying their own properties to precipitate eviction orders, vacate orders by the DLB, and then refusing to let tenants back in. So some of the sort of demographic indicators: the Hispanic population has declined by 22% in Community Board 1 in Brooklyn, the white population has increased by 36%, and the total foreign-born population has decreased by 10%. Finally, and I actually forgot to, this is the Arizona agreement, I forgot to switch. For you, it's probably not that issue, but the purple used to be industrial, and it, you can see the left is before, right is after. You can see how much industry remained and how much had become mixed use, which de facto has become residential now. Now, the next slide, which is actually what I'm interested in now, this is a rendering of the new project that just broke ground called Greenpoint Landing. It's anticipated to generate about 5,500 units in 10 buildings spread across the northeast or northwest part of the waterfront. If you can see there, that's where the Newtown Creek and the East River meet, the northwest tip of Greenpoint. This has created what the urban scholar Peter Marcuse would call a citadel, or the fears of a citadel. Now, a citadel, as opposed to a ghetto or an enclave, according to Marcuse, is a an area of concentrated area of wealth and privilege. And the fear is really that the waterfront is becoming one of these citadels. An urban planner by the name of Brian Paul has done some interesting work in actually tracing the development of what he calls the condo corridor, which really pretty much starts at the Williamsburg Bridge and goes all the way up along the waterfront and wraps, beginning to wrap around into the Newtown Creek area in Greenpoint. This is an area that has a much higher median income and that is going to see the bulk of the demographic expansion and explosion over the next several years. Now, the question is, what's going to happen with respect to city services, parks, for example? There's sentiment now in Greenpoint that this newly emerging condo corridor is going to draw resources from the rest of the neighborhood. That's going to be in the sort of, literally and figuratively, in the shadows of the condos that are emerging on the waterfront. Okay, so finally, I want to turn quickly to the lessons learned and some recommendations as we put forth in the issue brief. So the first, I suppose, would be there should need to be more resources committed to preserving low-income, working-class, immigrant tenants in these neighborhoods. The tenant legal fund, as I mentioned, the $2 million fund, was interesting and instructive in two respects. First, it indicated that there was a real need for housing assistance and tenant-related assistance, and secondly, indicated that that need was vastly insufficient. That those 2 years of support for tenant services, which came late in the day in 2008, which was a full 3 years after the rezoning, and ended in 2010, both began too late and ended too early. That is, the displacement started before the rezoning and has continued well after the rezoning, as we can still see today. Secondly, new legal measures should be adopted to preserve affordable housing. Policy reforms, rent laws, it goes without saying, should be strengthened. Vacancy decontrol, which is the ability for landlords to take their units out of rent stabilization regulation, which is actually quite easy for landlords to be able to do once apartments are vacated, simply by performing renovations and self sort of certifying the costs. And tenants have very little recourse, new tenants that are moving in, to challenge the basis for these new rent levels and even landlord decisions to take units off of the market or out of regulation. So vacancy decontrol, which is what allows that to happen, should be repealed. Simply put, the number of new units produced through affordable housing programs has not, and it seems cannot, keep pace with the affordable units that have been lost through policies like vacancy decontrol. Related, in some ways, policy reform would be to institute a tenant right to counsel. Tenants don't have this right. 90% of tenants aren't represented in housing court, whereas 90% of landlords are. It's a vastly uneven playing field, and providing resources for legal services to tenants is something that the city council is actually considering and discussing now. It would actually be cost effective if it prevents homelessness and the expensive shelter system. The anti-harassment zone should be also revived, but also strengthened. It was a sort of bureaucratically cumbersome policy, but if the mayor's office had a special enforcement division to enforce anti-harassment provisions and prevent landlords from changing their building structures or CFOs without first getting certification that tenants haven't been harassed, that would hopefully keep landlords on better behavior. Additional enforcement to prevent illegal short-term rentals, that's actually something that's also been proposed recently in the city council, a task force to basically scope out Airbnb rentals that are violating rent regulation laws. And then last couple of points, real affordable housing. The city can do something very quickly, it seems, with respect to Greenpoint and Winsburg, and that is to move forward on the city-owned plots of land that have not yet been redeveloped into affordable housing. It's been 10 years now, and there's a considerable amount of, well, not that much, but there are parcels out there which have been slated for development, nonprofit development into affordable housing that haven't been developed. The Greenpoint Hospital is a prime example of over 260 units that could be produced, much more affordable than what's being produced now. Now, it seems that inclusionary zoning, voluntary inclusionary zoning, clearly hasn't worked. The jury's still obviously out on mandatory inclusionary zoning, we'll see. In addition, public housing, there is public housing, not much, but there is some public housing in Greenpoint that should be protected and strengthened. Recently, the NYCHA has gone into partnerships with private banks to essentially sell off portions of their privatized portions of their building stock. This is something that should be looked at with a great deal of alarm, because it calls into question the long-term viability of public housing. We can have discussion over 421A. It seems that that's coming up for renewal in June. But to what extent tax abatement programs among other things, serve to increase the value and price of land, which makes it much more difficult for affordable housing developers and community land trusts to actually acquire land to be able to create permanently affordable housing. And then finally, planning, community-based planning. There were plans, the 197A plans had been certified. The whole process had been painful at times, process had been endured. And at the end, of course, the city just threw the plans out the window. So there should be some recognition, and community-based plans, 197A plans, should be the basis for city policy and not something to consider or not. And I'll end just with an anecdote. I was recently at a meeting in community planning meeting, actually organized in part by the DCP, Department of City Planning, along with residents and community groups in Bushwick, the next frontier, as it were, discussing potential rezoning in Bushwick. Bushwick's at the very early stages of considering rezoning. But what was interesting was the person who was chairing the meeting, who's a community board chair, began the meeting by saying, thank you everybody for coming. This is a very important process. We don't want to end up like Williamsburg and Greenpoint. And I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Great. Thank you, Sam and Philip, for these fantastic bird's eye views of what's going on there, on the ground views of the gentrification process that's going on. I want to turn to Peter and Ida next, and then Margaret and I will have some follow-ups and questions. But Peter, do you want to start and push us to some deeper
thinking? Before that, there's still two more seats. I think you guys should come.
Yeah.
It's it's nice to have people standing to come to your conference, but it's not nice. Sorry, we don't have all these chairs for you. Could you guys come over? At least there's two seats here.
There's a few chairs outside behind the store too. Do you want to grab them?
So, Phil and Sam brought up quite a few different issues, and I'm sure many of you have a lot of questions and comments to make. I want to make my comments very brief, just two main points. When I first started talking about gentrification in Chinatown, fighting against it, people always say, you're nuts. You know, I mean, everywhere else is gentrified. What is so special about Chinatown? And so there is this view that somehow gentrification is a natural process. Somehow, you know, what's the point of fighting it? And you just might as well just lay down and enjoy it. But as you can see, gentrification is very much a political process, right? It's not just simply capitalism or fighting against each other and you come, but increasingly in New York City, it's basically political. Political in the sense that it depends on the zoning laws, it depends on tax abatement, it depends on laws protecting or not protecting the tenants. So the political system in New York City, in that case New York State, had very much to do how a community develops, or whether they've been gentrified quickly or not. Now we are talking about big games now, and gentrification has always happened. In Chinatown, my book 20 years ago, I talk about gentrification of the smaller capital coming to New York Chinatown. And it was difficult, but since 2000 we've basically talking about quite a different climate. That a lot of big money is coming. We have low interest rates. We have the economy pretty much switch away from industrial manufacture to investment in real estate. So we have to see that the fight of Chinatown is a political one. And the problem, however, is because the stake's so big, the developers, their allies, and the banks had all the tools, right? They could hire lobbyists, they could hire lawyers, they could have real estate people, all that kind of stuff. And they could, I don't want to suggest, but my lord, city council and all these people have been, getting money from developers. So for communities under attack, it's always very, very difficult, right? Particularly like Chinatown, a new immigrant community that basically trying to survive, and that the kind of sophisticated development process oftentimes is not understood, right? So this is the point I'm trying to say here, that the fact of the matter is, in Chinatown, you could really say there is a legitimate struggle to fight against gentrification, right? Sam talked about the fact that BID. Everybody understood what BID is about. BID is trying to make Chinatown more beautiful, therefore increase its land value, so it's attractive to investments, right? So a lot of people sign up petitions against the BID. That struggle still goes on. Amazing. The fight for getting a 197C, try to have a community planning, that has gone on for how many years?
7 years,
right? So many community groups devoted time trying to get compromise negotiation to try to get a kind of a agreement so we could protect Chinatown. And so this thing's still unfolding, that the competition is not very equal, but nevertheless, you could see Chinatown is fighting. Why are Chinatown fighting? And this is where I think it's very, very important to understand the nature of Chinatown. I think you're going to laugh at me now. Chinatown is where people live, work, socialize, right? But it's not just about that. It's about a economic networking that creates jobs, creates work, that sustain a community. It has been sustaining that community since 1970. As you probably know, Chinatown was only 11,000 population. 70s onwards, increased to 10 times or many, many more times, right? And yet, year in, year out, we are able to develop work. Now, there was a development of the garment industry collapsed at the end of the 1990s for very obvious reasons, competition in China. But nevertheless, since that time on, Chinatown community has created new different jobs, right? So the people who were out of work able to find new work, right? And what's even more important is that the kind of work that's being created, the kind of jobs being created, it's not just about survival of Chinese population in Chinatown, but it's creating jobs for further incoming populations. Look how many takeout places, look how many restaurants outside of New York City. I mean, if you travel around the country, everywhere you see, you know, Chinese restaurants, some of the Japanese restaurants that are actually Chinese. So what Chinatown has actually able to do is created a kind of economic network. Right. So if you open a restaurant, you need supplies, you need furniture, you don't want what? It comes through Chinatown. Knowledge, know-how, financing comes through Chinatown. So the meaning of Chinatown is much more than a place. It's much more than a place where people live. It's much more than people try to get low-income housing. Right? So that is the significance of Chinatown. And so gentrification would destroy all of that. And one of the reasons it would destroy all of that is that, you know, a lot of people look at Chinatown as a place for cheap labor. A lot of people look at Chinatown as a backward place, right? Everything's kind of out of date. Many of my Chinese American friends come to me and says, you know, why can't the Chinese do things better? Why can't they adopt, you know, more modern things to attract more tourists? Well, that is really misunderstanding the very nature of Chinatown. The nature of Chinatown economy is small, competitive businesses capable of hiring a lot of people, a lot of people able to have jobs. Right? It's not about monopoly, it's not about efficiency, but rather accommodate new immigrants. So they have a place to live, they have a place they're able to survive. And so competition's intense, but you know, that for instance, in Chinatown, if you want to order meat, there are hundreds of different places to order meat. The result is that competition makes that price low, right? At the same time, providing jobs, but not great jobs, sometimes not even very, but nevertheless, it is economic structure that works for the new immigrants. Right? Without it, you're talking about a collapse of the economy that will not be able to function, that will not be able to help helping the new immigrants coming to the United States. So that's what is at stake. That's why the Chinatown community instinctively understand, right? Gentrification is a threat. gentrification, any kind of a... So the last point is this. The plan that we proposed for the Chinatown Working Group is a very, very conservative plan. The main thing is not about creating more and more low-income housing. The most important thing is protect what the housing, the business establishment as is now, right? So it's not about, because a lot of people would say, well, Chinatown needs new housing. Well, the logic carries exactly into this neoliberal thing. Since there's no public housing financed by the public sector, so you have to go to the private sector. The private sector is not going to build some building without some kind of an advantage. So this is where about inclusion zoning comes in. Inclusion zoning does not address shortage of housing, as you can see, right? And just assume you built a high skyscraper right in the middle of Chinatown, right? Okay. Let's say 20%. Let's even 40% for the working class poor. Even if it's, let's say, right, but you still got 60-70% people coming in who are paying regular rent. Their demands, their desires, going to be different from the community, right? So inclusion zoning inevitably lead to gentrification. I just want to leave to say that one is political. The secondly is the fact that. I think there is a lot of strength in the Chinese community and a lot of worries about how to protect what they have.
Great. Thanks, Peter. Ida?
Well, just to say that I really appreciate what everybody said here, and that I've been working in the Greenpoint-Williamsburg area for a long time, and over time, some of the things become clear, and particularly, I think what we need to understand, I think Peter said, you know, you think gentrification is natural, but we have to understand the processes that have led to the situation we're in. And for over the last 30 years, the changes have all of them reflected political battles. They weren't like, they didn't have to happen that way. Like, if we look under the Lindsay administration in the 1960s, they began to recognize that industry was leaving New York and that real estate and finance, what they call FIRE, finance, insurance, and real estate, would become the basis, or they, certain people in power decided that was the basis for New York City. And so what happened was, while in up until 1975, there had been a lot of investment, new firehouses, new Mitchell Lama buildings, new public housing, new swimming pools, new parks. There was an idea up until 1975 that the city was built for the people who lived there, that the city, as a city government, should be responding to the people who live there. Although they should also, of course, be looking for jobs, be looking for new investment, be built. What happened in 1975 is still so crucial to us today, because we think of New York City, and you hear this all the time, that the New York City of the 60s, of the 70s was poor. In fact, there were less poor children living in New York City in 1975 than there are today. There were no homeless people in New York City. There was a Cuomo housing report done in 1978 or something, which said they could only find 35 homeless families in 1975. And by 1980, we had 10,000. I mean, the shift between 1975 and 1980 was the shift which people think of as New York was down the drain and we had to do something, and so we had to bring in this real estate investment. But what actually happened was that, just to give you a slight background, I don't want to go on forever, was that the Kennedy-Johnson administrations, way historical, invested in cities, they invested in the Northeast, they invested in California, you had the best university systems, things like that. When Nixon came to power, you got in that White House, Cheney, Rumsfeld, people you may recognize, and even though Nixon ended up with being pushed out with Watergate, under the Ford regime, It was still those same people who developed the neoliberal model, which you're all familiar with. That model started, and the very first city that was infected by it in the US, and before Margaret Thatcher or anyone like that, was when Ford said to New York City, drop dead. That was 1975. And the reason New York City was in debt was partly because under the Democratic administration, and I'm not saying the Democrats are wonderful, the Republicans are bad, but I'm just saying what happened, they changed policy. Under the Democratic administration, there had been an investment in cities. They saw cities as the center of their constituency. And African Americans, minorities, so they were investing in cities. Once Nixon-Ford regime came in, they wanted to invest in the Southwest, and military, and nuclear, and they put a lot of money in Nevada, and places like that. They wanted to invest in the middle part of America, which has a lot of senators, but very few people. And that is where they put their investment. And they took it out of New York City. So when New York City had planned Lincoln Center, housing, everything like that, on the basis of being the global city for the United States, supported by the federal government. By 1975, they were getting less back to New York City than they paid in taxes. So what happened was that they obviously, you know, were a poor bet for people who wanted to put their money into New York because the federal government had cut them off. And then when you hear about all of the Bronx burning down, that was 75 to 78. A lot of it was abandoned buildings. Why were the buildings abandoned? Because the landlords abandoned them, because the idea was there's no more investment in New York City. The Lower East Side burnt down between 75 and 78. Lots and lots of buildings. People were homeless. People were in hospitals. Every night there were different buildings burning down. Partly because people were sleeping without homes and had no heating, and partly because landlords found it advantageous, as Philip says, still does happen, to burn their buildings down because they couldn't, then they could start again and reinvest and deal with the rent cap. So this policy change is a political event. And for the next 25 years, what they did, they created 421A that was mentioned today. It was created after the fiscal crisis, which meant that if you built a nice luxury building, those people, you could apply for property. You don't have to pay, your people you sell those apartments to or rent them to don't have to pay property taxes. So 421A, there's something like 3,000 or 4,000 luxury buildings now built since the 1980s in New York City that are 421A. Nobody there pays property taxes. That's really important. The other thing which nobody remembers anymore is J51, which was introduced, which allowed people who were in rent-stabilized buildings, the landlord could fix it up, put in a new bathroom or kitchen, and take it out of rent regulation. All of these things, and then of course the Republican Party fought for rent regulation to be restricted, which we have to get back, but they made income limits and all sorts of legal, and at the same time, over the past 30 years, the Legal Aid Society under Giuliani, up until about, when was Giuliani? 92 or somewhere?
94.
Okay, so about 92, 93, Giuliani destroyed our legal aid. They took away, he fired all the legal aid lawyers who had been paid by the city, so that if you had a case, you could get a legal aid lawyer and rent control or rent regulation, you could, all of them. They kept like the top 100 or something who were kind of in the very unassailable positions, who had previously been kind of the theoretical lawyers and never even went out to the Bronx, but it looked at the law. They fired everybody. And so legal aid, I used to work in public assistance. I was doing research as an anthropologist. Whenever we went to any of the public assistance offices, there would be legal aid lawyers there that could come in with us to see the welfare case. The same with housing. Anytime you had a problem with housing, you could have a legal aid lawyer help you through the processes. Now we're fighting for that same thing again. So there was a long erosion. However, people were pushed mostly out of Manhattan. So the Lower East Side was burned down, as I mentioned. But then it set itself up as arty, theater, artists, etc. Well, there was battles there with 1990 Tompkins Square Park. And people know that they think of Tompkins Square Park, I guess, as some kind of homeless riot. I don't know what you think about it as. But in 1990, there was a lot of gentrification going on the Lower East Side. And it was an interesting coalition. It was artists, actors, anarchists, homeless people, and they all occupied the park in opposition to gentrification. And it went on for 2 or 3 years until actually Mayor Dinkins had people removed by the police, because Mayor Dinkins was being attacked by corporate wealth and really pushed. The same thing happened to Dinkins that happened in 1975, but in a smaller way. He was like, money was cut off from what was offered to that administration, our first black mayor. And he ended up having to fire 500,000 city workers, as happened in 1975. That was like 92. So there was an assault on the mayor for trying to change things and the gentrification. But this was a slow process. So all of those actors and artists and kids and etc., the sort of raffish side of the city, the cultural side of the city, to put it that way, moved into Greenpoint, Williamsburg around that time, which was a working class neighborhood. And my first book is about how it was a working class neighborhood. It wasn't an empty neighborhood. It wasn't a useless neighborhood. It was a neighborhood where people could afford their housing. And they all, many, many people had jobs. They were construction workers, they were bartenders, they were the women that swept, you know, the Polish and American and Puerto Rican women who swept all the buildings of Manhattan when you went home at night. They were doing that work, and they were living in, that's the ones I interviewed, in Greenpoint, Williamsburg. And some of them, with those kind of incomes, could even afford to buy a house, because you could sell a house for $12,000 in the 70s. Anyway, so what happened, it was slow. So what happened, a lot of the theaters moved out to Williamsburg, and it was, again, a very vital neighborhood. My students or your students, everybody moved out there. Greenpoint, Williamsburg, it was not a depressed neighborhood. It was a vibrant neighborhood. And when you look at the migrants who were coming in, they were earning under $30,000 a year. So it was in need of housing. It was filling up. People were sharing, these young people, 6 and 7 people to an apartment. They were taking over the warehouses and living in them. And guess what? They were fighting to improve the neighborhood. All those people who came from Lower East Side, they understood about gentrification. And they were fixing up their neighborhood for themselves to stay there as renters and owners. So they built a coalition, which is the one that fought Bloomberg in 2005. That was a 30-year creation of that coalition. And those people, they forced, when they repainted the Williamsburg Bridge and all the lead was spraying all over Greenpoint, they fought that and they stopped it. When Giuliani wanted to put sanitation plants all along the waterfront, that's what he was going to use the spare land for. They stopped the sanitation plants because he was trying to get out of, it's all political, he was trying to get out of fresh kills, because Giuliani was elected by Staten Island and his promise was he'd take the dump out of Staten Island. So he wanted to put it in Brooklyn. So that's what they were trying to do, and the neighborhood fought against that. They fought against the toxic fumes from the dry cleaners. They got garbage collected, get buildings sealed up, etc. So they made it a very exciting, vibrant neighborhood. And then they got 197A, which was their idea for community improvement. There is an alternative. That's the main point I want to make. There is an alternative in every neighborhood, and there's one in Chinatown now. They got that approved by the Giuliani administration and by city planning. It was all completely certified and approved and ready to go, the one the neighborhood had worked out. Then we had 9/11. After 9/11, which you could call a wounded city, I've worked with people on the concept of wounded cities. When a city, not just with 9/11, but in some kind of crash, when these kind of disasters happen or wars, the local people lose a lot of say. Everyone's in terror, everyone's in fear. The local politicians are afraid. They said Chinatown was in recession. They said the city was in recession. So what did Bloomberg did? 2002, he brought in all the businessmen. He is a businessman. And he changed the zoning and developed this huge plan for Greenpoint, Williamsburg. And there was less political opposition, because all the opposition was, the demonstrations after 9/11 were shadowed by police on motorbikes, by those police horses they put down the middle. They were incredibly repressed after 2001, 2002, 2003. Whole city. You haven't had a demonstration without 100,000 of police until like last year with Bill de Blasio. So all under Bloomberg, there was incredible repression of all these kind of things. And what happened was he decided to reopen this kind of neoliberal, he found a wide open channel with a lack of opposition in 2002 to do this huge rezoning around the city and to make money. Now those rezonings are gambling. Our need for housing is in people who are earning under 40,000 a year. That's the highest need. The 6% housing which justifies these buildings is all for people earning under 40 or 50,000 a year. We don't have a shortage of luxury housing in the city. They use a figure that's used for the whole city, but when you look at the different income level, there's no shortage. If you're earning over 150,000 or 100, there's no shortage at all of luxury housing. And it's a big gamble. The developers get the money from the investors. Nobody puts any money into it. The city loses its property taxes. What happens is then people from all of the, what you would call the places like China, India, where we've sent our industry and where there are local elites who've made a lot of money on the industry that left New York, they now are looking for safe places to invest, and they buy these million, $10, $20, $30 million apartments, not only in the Trump buildings, but also throughout Williamsburg. And that's why we have hotels and restaurants that no normal New Yorker could go to now in Williamsburg. And that is a gamble. It's a New York City investment gamble with our taxes on the international global market, that people will still see New York as a stable place to invest their money. And it has nothing at all to do with the residents of the people who've lived in the city now or 40 years ago. Nothing at all to do with anyone here at Hunter College or in any other place where people are earning under $500,000 a year. It doesn't have to do. So the evictions in Williamsburg are people earning like 100,000. They can't afford to live there anymore, never mind the young people. And this is what this new transition, this is like the massive displacement since 2000. You can't even call it gentrification. You have to call it something else. It's not the same as we were analyzing from 1980 to 2000. It's just not the same. It's a massive displacement. And you've had the figures that, of course, it's all the poor people who've been pushed out, people, Hispanics, minorities. And now in Chinatown, you'll see a very similar process.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much.
Yes, so I really appreciate this discussion. This is actually excellent. And I actually first want to ask this group, the Williamsburg Greenpoint section, and I'll comment on both first, to think a little bit about how you would give suggestions for Chinatown, knowing what's happened. And I want to start knowing what's happened, because I actually think Williamsburg and Greenpoint is about 10 to 15 years ahead of what could happen in Chinatown. Now, I'm going to bring back to what you said about 2000, because I really do think that things drastically different has happened in Chinatown since 2000, since 2001, and specifically with the downing of the World Trade Centers, and actually the loss of the garment industry in Chinatown. Because that whole economic networking that Peter just mentioned, you could see the strength of that throughout the 1990s. Even though the garment industry was decreasing, the incubation for jobs there with the garment industry, with the restaurant industry, they brought in people from all the different Chinatowns. At that point, Sunset Park was growing, Flushing was already growing. So Chinatown in of itself was more than just tourists. It was actually quite an incubator for all these other different kinds of services. Barbershop salons, you know, restaurants for the working people as well as housing for the people there. So maybe I want you to think a little bit, the question for the Chinatown group is, since 2000, how else would you address that need? I mean, Chinatown has changed since 2000. So you need to think about, I think you probably have to address housing as well as the commercial industry, as well as jobs. So what kind of ideas would you suggest? And then for the Brooklyn group to comment on.
Yeah.
what the Chinatown group thinks of that?
Yeah, I mean, that's an excellent question. I think that's sort of what we're trying to start to do, is to think about how these two experiences can kind of speak to each other. I guess, you know, there are differences, obviously, significant differences between the two neighborhoods or communities, but there are also similar sort of commonalities. And I think in thinking about what can be done to sort of prevent what had happened in Greenpoint, Williamsburg to happen in Chinatown, you know, one of the, I think, dilemmas that many groups in Greenpoint and Williamsburg faced was how to, particularly nonprofits who were involved in housing, right, how to organize kind of on the ground in oppositional sort of forms of organizing to prevent gentrification, while also maintaining a tie to the development industry through the development of nonprofit housing. Mm-hmm. And that created fractures and fissures within, not even just across organizations, but actually within organizations themselves in some ways. So this is a larger question that goes well beyond Chinatown and Greenpoint. I would say that what Peter sort of suggested is rejecting the kind of ideology of the growth machine, right? That growth is in and of itself a good. That kind of growth is in and of itself a good. Legal aid colleagues of mine would like to see no new development along the lines of what Peter was saying, because any sort of market redevelopment at this point is generating more displacement than it is compensated for in the form of, you know, the additional units that it could sort of be to offset that development. So I think that's something that Greenpoint Williamsburg could illustrate, has illustrated quite well. The idea of commercial rent control is something also that has been raised, even though how it would work in practice, if it would go to some sort of arbitration. You know, there are details, devils in the details, of course, but, you know, rent regulations should be upheld, strengthened, but, and I think they should be thought in terms of applied to commercial establishments as well. So I guess those are the two sort of brief comments I would have.
What I would say is that Chinatown has differences, and Peter really laid them out. But I'd say that, you know, Harlem is having the same issues, the Bronx is having the same issues, Bushwick, I hear...
Sheepshead Bay and Brighton Beach.
Yeah, and East New York even is beginning, and never mind Clinton, which is long gone. So the point I would like to make is that de Blasio was elected on a wave of people's movements. There were movements all over the city, and he was elected on a wave of criticism of the Bloomberg rezoning. That's who elected de Blasio. He was a nobody. I don't mean he was bad, but he was unknown. He was a dark horse. People thought it would either be Christine Quinn or, you know, de Blasio came out of the blue because people were looking for an alternative, and that is his base. Now, I think that it has to be citywide. I think you can talk about Chinatown and you can talk, but if people could, what Chinatown needs to do is to bring in all the other groups and fight for the support of 197A. Every neighborhood had a 197A. They still have one. It's still certified. You know, ours, Greenpoint Williamsburg, was thrown out. The 197A is a product of community work. It's exactly what we think. We don't need to rethink it. And I think that if you had a citywide movement to say to de Blasio, you can't throw out these years of work. You have to listen to the community. These are the people that voted you in. These are the people you're going to need. And I think if it was citywide, not only would it help Chinatown, it would help a lot of other places. And I think people could start in Chinatown calling in, like in Brooklyn, the Greenpoint one, it was a North Brooklyn Alliance. It was a group all the way across Brooklyn that fought the 2005 rezoning. It was churches, it was unions, it was, you know, all the different groups around Brooklyn that joined together. And I think that that's a call that could really relate to so many different neighborhoods who are on the fringe. Yeah, Chinatown's just changing, but so are all these other places. And other ones, who's living in all those places? This is all the people pushed out from Manhattan, the Lower East Side, Greenpoint, Williamsburg, Park Slope, whatever. So I think that Chinatown could be a rallying point, and that would be the way to stop it.
You asked the question, basically what should Chinatown do? There is a need for housing, there's a need for jobs. How do we bring that back?
Yeah, and commercial, right,
It's true. I think Peter reinforced the sort of conservative nature of the advocacy plan in that it's radical in the political context as those things are off the table, but the point is to keep what we have. I think the strangest part of the Chinatown Working Group plan is the part about economic development, where it proposes incubators for food manufacturing and incubators for jewelry selling, and all these things are already done in Chinatown. Chinatown is the incubator. You don't need the building with all the stuff in it, but that's sort of how planners have been trained to think. I think moving away from that model and instead focusing on what's actually there and works is really important. Peter also made it clear these are not necessarily good jobs that are the core of what's in Chinatown, but the solution to that is organizing and unionizing, doing all the things that make them good jobs. Gentrification is presented as somewhat of a solution because it displaces jobs, but those were bad jobs anyway. But it doesn't replace them with anything for the people that lost their jobs. So the answer is in preserving and in organizing. Maybe there needs to be the construction of new housing. I mean, there's certainly a crunch, but all the models that have been presented will squeeze that further rather than actually expand the possibilities.
I happen to disagree with analysis that 1990s somehow the garment industry was something that we missed. Garment industry started in 1970s. It was something that was very, very useful for the Chinese community, because a lot of new immigrants coming here, they bring their family, their kids and all that. But the garment industry became highly, highly exploitative. That is to say that what the garment industry basically doing is trying to lower and lower, keep lowering the wages, so the Chinese ladies working in the garment factories could compete with whoever if you go to South, compete with the Southern workers, go to Mexico, and eventually competing with China, right? That's not a sustainable model. So the collapse of garment industry actually in some ways is not a tragedy. As a matter of fact, my book on forbidden workers talk about it. The 1990s is the worst period in terms of income, in terms of poverty, in terms of wage level, and sweatshop prevailed. So what is interesting about this is the demise of the garment industry led to a new spurt of innovations businesses, right? So actually, without these, garment factories, you're talking about 300 or 400 workers, many workers. Now, with their demise, actually you have going back to small model, smaller businesses. And in that sense, the fact that they lost the garment industry, and the fact 10 years later, they are creating far more new jobs, that's what's significant. See, this is where I really find it puzzling. People always come to Chinatown, and Chinese Americans and everybody comes to China and says, we need a development model. But Chinese community, they have their development model, right? All these new businesses created, they didn't get any federal funding, all right? They didn't get banks' money. This is kind of an immigrant community developed these kind of initiative, not only as I mentioned to you, it's under a lot of pressure, but they are creating more jobs. They're creating jobs that's creating jobs for people who are outside of a Chinese community. So, I think one of the things I also find it problematic with this Chinatown Working Group is this whole thing about development. All planners always somehow we have to develop something. For God's sake, how many development minority committee ever succeeded, right? It's always somebody doing something, and the point is you have a situation that the immigrants are creating. They're not jobs that you think is great, but it is a job that under the circumstances, they are in there. This is what they created. All right. Now, I'm not saying that that's great, that shouldn't be changed. All I'm trying to say is you got to give them credit for what they have done. All right. And one of the more important points is to try to protect that. Otherwise, you know, then the community collapse and a lot of jobs will be lost. Where are these people going to find jobs?
Right. Can I say one more thing? So in the history of New York, there was this battle, you know, it was Robert Moses who built all the highways and was going to put a highway through Greenwich Village. And the idea was we had to have development. And Jane Jacobs, who represents the other point of view, said it's neighborhoods, the sort of thing that Peter's saying, that you need to preserve the networks. In fact, you know, if we had followed the whole, and there was a lot of unrest and resistance following Jane Jacobs against Robert Moses, and by the end of the 60s, he was thrown out. But the point is, what we have in New York is a mixture of these things, that he wanted to put a highway straight down the west side and across the middle of Greenwich Village. They stopped that. So now we have parks all the way down the west side. We have, you know, Washington Square, we have a very mixed economy of Greenwich Village, Lower East Side, that everybody values. So I think that we need to take both of these points of view, and that the kind of thing that you're seeing here is kind of doesn't recognize in any way what this city is made of and what has made this city a place people want to come to and a place people want to live in. Well, all the areas that we're talking about. So it's very important to see that those battles are ongoing and that there's always this struggle between pushing people out and rebuilding for the car and rebuilding for the developers. But then there's the people on the ground and how they actually go shopping and how they actually get to school. And none of that is being considered in the new development and where they shop and where they work.
So I just want to acknowledge that we've had a tour de force here of ethnographic presentations and theoretical thinking and helping us get a lot deeper into thinking about what's going on in New York City today. So this is, for me, this has just been a delight to be here and listen to you all. It's been fantastic. We have the room till 6:30. Which is 23 minutes. So I think it would be appropriate if there are questions from the floor. I got Tari, and then we'll go around in different ways.
Great, well, thank you. Yeah, thank you for the presentations.
Would you mind introducing yourself?
My name is Tari Hum, and I'm a faculty member at Queens College. I actually just finished a piece for Gotham Gazette, which is on a proposal for Sunset Park, which I think actually brings some elements of both, of all three neighborhoods that have been discussed, because Sunset Park is considered one of New York City's satellite Chinatowns. It has a very large and growing Chinese population. But much like Greenpoint, Williamsburg, it is also, or what is also, an industrial waterfront neighborhood. And so there, and I think that, Philip, you had mentioned the Bushwick meeting in which the CB district manager said that we don't want to end up like Williamsburg. Well, there was a press conference that was held a few Sundays ago in Sunset Park regarding the Industry City $1 billion proposal to kind of renovate the industrial space, a large portion of the industrial space on the waterfront to accommodate the creative economy that's based on technology, media, advertising, fashion, et cetera. And organizers have responded, we don't want to become like Williamsburg. So I guess my question is, one, pertaining also to the fact about 197A's and community planning. The city, not the city, but there used to be a campaign for community-based planning that was out of the Municipal Art Society that was really trying to organize to have 197 days enforceable. That has since disbanded. I don't know if you know of any effort to kind of revitalize that, you know, in an effort to kind of have a meaningful community-based planning. But the other question had to do, my other question had to do with industrial retention. You had mentioned that there was a fund that was set aside for industrial retention. Is there any industrial that is left in Williamsburg that doesn't look like the creative economy, which is what we're afraid is going to be the gentrifying factor in the Sunset Park industrial waterfront?
So, yeah, that's actually very interesting. That you asked that, because as we were discussing the sort of links between Chinatown and Greenpoint Williamsburg, it just sort of dawned on me that I actually live next door. I knew this already, obviously, but what dawned on me is the sort of enormity of this. I live next door to the grocery warehouse distributor that provides all the produce to Joe's Shanghai and various different places in Chinatown, and I'm adjacent to bordering the East Williamsburg Industrial Zone. And there are a lot of similar operations there. There is a very direct link between the vitality, I sense, in Chinatown, serving Chinatown, and places like East Williamsburg Industrial Retention Zone, because, or Industrial Development Zone, because of obviously the link to, well, we have Moses to thank for this, ironically, to the BQE. And so, you know, there is a very direct sort of logistical link there in terms of what goes on policy with respect to industrial retention. It's there, but it's also under threat. And it's under threat from a different kind of creative economy. And that's the film and television industry in Greenpoint and Williamsburg, which has come to dominate much of the industrial land and trying to get, you know, entire streets demapped, which, you know, sort of runs up against basic quality of life issues for residents who don't like film crews, you know, stealing parking spaces and all that stuff. But I, even though this is something that I sort of anecdotally observed, I think there is a struggle for the industry. It's not that all industrial uses are under threat, because the film industry in Greenpoint is powerful enough to be able to retain and expand its presence in Greenpoint, and particularly Greenpoint. But it's precisely what kind of jobs, right? Who's it going to? It's not going to locals. Right? It's quite clear that the jobs that are being produced are crews that come in and out that have no relationship to the local economy. And I'm not trying to be a sort of nativist here, but in terms of, you know, where, how policy is made and how groups sort of in residents and in sort of communities, if you will, define land use and have a say over land use, it seems to me that the kinds of uses that precisely provide jobs for low-income new arrivals to the country and to the city, those are the ones that are primarily under threat. But, you know, I think that maybe there's some way to organize across communities through these very direct links, mm-hmm. but I haven't seen that, I haven't read about it, I don't know, but I'd be interested in talking about it, definitely.
Fantastic. There was a, all right, we'll go this way. Is there right next to Tari?
Yes. Are you all familiar with the Small Business Job Survival Act? I know Peter made reference to April 402 before the City Council would protect artists, studios, and businesses from displacement. And that's a very important part of fighting gentrification. It's both residences and businesses making up New York City as it is, instead of just becoming another big box old city mall.
Rob, do you know much about this?
I'd like to hear of.
No, but then I have a very different question.
And also the Artist Studio Affordability Project website, artiststudioaffordabilityproject.org, has the text of the bill.
The unfortunate development in this case is we in gentrification literature talks a great deal about is that gentrification oftentimes began with artists to the extent that, you know, they look for spaces, they are usually the most astute in terms of finding good space, cheap areas. And that oftentimes lead to their own demise. So in the case of, if you want to talk about Chinatown, it's really interesting. If you go to Orchard Street, mm-hmm. Orchard Street used to be the Jewish shopping area and has not been doing well for many, many years, and you still have some old stores there. If you go down there, you will find, starting from the very bottom, which is near Canal Street, is opening up these art studios, some of the crappiest stuff that you could ever imagine. And you say, what is going on? Nobody's buying these things, right? And, well, that is basically what's going on. As you mentioned, trying to make the area somehow signaling it's upscale now, that you could in fact see the potential for development. Mm-hmm. So, this kind of stuff is not protecting artists either. So, you know, we are talking about artists is one of the least protected group as it is today. I mean, you know, starting from they've been chased all over the place. And so anyway, so the kind of galleries in Orchard Street is basically not the kind of protection of artists. So I get what you're saying, and I think in all creative or small need to have some kind of protection. In the case of Chinatown, there is none.
Mm-hmm. All right, that's the answer.
Me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm Rob Hollander. I teach anthropology at John Jay. And in full disclosure, I'm the secretary of the Chinatown Working Group. I want to raise the problem of the fragmentation within Chinatown. I think it's very important that Chinatown has tremendous strength, especially its labor and residents are very vocal when they need to be and when they understand when to be. But when you look at the nonprofits, and this is not just true of Chinatown, it's true of the entire city, the nonprofits have a mission. They are funded for that mission, and that mission is to build affordable housing in many cases. And to get that affordable housing, they've got to bring in developers for the 80% or 7%, whatever it is, of market-rate luxury development. They are the motivators of more development, more expansion, and you look at, for example, to be blunt, Asian Americans for Equality. Who sponsored the Business Improvement District? It was Asian Americans for Equality. And at the same time, there's even groups like the Asian American Federation. Their study has states within it that the small businesses are the most thriving sector, right? In particular, East Broadway, the Fujianese is a local business that serve the local residents. Right? They were not harmed particularly by 9/11. They are thriving, everybody else is dying. And yet the Asian American Federation's recommendations are, well, let's face towards tourism, let's have more of this development. And of course, those are the things that have been failing. And they completely ignore the success of Fujianese in East Broadway. So there's this fragmentation within Chinatown, and perhaps most dangerously with the nonprofits, because AFI is maybe the biggest political broker. And they were one of the sponsors of the East Village Lower East Side rezoning because they wanted to see that upzoning of Christie Street in Chinatown. I mean, you see this in every rezoning. The nonprofits come forward and they say, yes, we love this rezoning. And then you see the non-funded residents who don't want to be gentrified. They come to the microphone one by one without some T-shirt from the nonprofit organization, and they said, "No, we don't want this." But their voice is overwhelmed because, of course, the nonprofits also have the backing of a political organization, which is motivating the whole thing. Where
where do you get the wedge in? You know, the community is being divided by it.
Well, I would not say the community is divided by it, and I think we need to know the history of community development cooperation, right? This is many of these organizations that you mentioned, when they first started out, they were actually community organizations fighting for the community, however successful they were. AFI was never that successful, but they were community groups trying to draw community strength, right? But what had happened is the logic is a lot of these community organizations do not want to survive on their own. They want money, they want funding, right? So they go wherever there are fundings, right? So you see so many of these groups that you talk about, church group you talk about in the city, right? They were doing great work, but now they all get into housing. Why? Because that's where the money is. Now, for instance, one of the examples I would give you, it's one of the more outrageous, right now we're actually trying to mount a demonstration, which is a site built on top of the Pathmark. Pathmark was a very, it was a kind of a very useful shopping area for a lot of people in Chinatown neighborhood. It's on a very obscure place close to the water. Developers got hold of it, right? Extel, right? They proposed to build a 48-story building for market rate. On the side of it, 13-story building for affordable housing. And if you look at the book sheet, right, the whole project's $150 to $160 million. And tax break is $70 or $80 million. And some other,
bonds.
Bonds or whatever. What they actually put up is $20 million.
Yeah, that's
and that money is actually from somebody else, right?
Yeah.
So what they actually is doing, however, is in order for this particular building to be approved, they have to have some community organizations that legitimize it. And this particular organization is Two Bridges, right? And Two Bridges supported this. And what happened is basically, if you understand what the deal is when this building is built, right? Two Bridges will be managing that 13-story building. Okay, there is nothing tricky about this. It's as plain as, you know. So in other words, so-called community organizations that is promoting low-income housings actually are helping developers to come into community, and their return is to managing these buildings, right? So one of the things that I don't know specific detail, what the developer wants to build higher buildings because they say, well, you know, this is not good enough. So who do they get support from? A community art group. The community art group wants a space. And the developer says, well, we don't think we've got enough space for you. If you support us for a higher building, right, we help. So what has happened? This particular art group supports higher high-rises in Chinatown. Okay, so there's no mystery. Are they community groups? I don't consider them community groups. All right, most of them do not belong to the community. All right, most of them, I don't want to get antagonized too many people. But the point is,
sorry.
The point is, as I mentioned very early, right, this is not a group set up to fight against gentrification. The community, these are just common folks, just like all the people in. They don't have the skills, they don't have the knowledge, they don't have the resources to have a good even fight, right? So of course, many of the people in the community are not necessarily understand what the state is, right? And a lot of the people felt, you know, we could live one day, live on another year, it's fine, okay? Why do you get involved? So the problem is the knowledge, the energy, the focus the communities lack. But as I think other people should know, but this is not just Chinatown's fight.
No.
This is everybody else's fight.
Do you want to respond to that?
Just very quickly, because I think that's a very important point that you're making. You know, this is not a new question either. People involved in looking at the nonprofit sector critically have been talking about so-called advocacy chill for quite some time when it comes to, you know, who holds the purse strings, right? But what makes it sort of more problematic now is that to play the game, it requires much more money, right? The costs of acquiring land, developing any kind of housing are so high that it's difficult to see. I mean, where's the wedge? Maybe the wedge is to bring the cost of land down. How do you do that? Stop subsidizing developers in the way that the existing policies do, right? Start looking for places, going after developers, people, landowners that are sitting on land that's being underutilized, that's lying vacant, right? Redirect efforts to bringing down the cost of land instead of playing that game. Would you say that?
Cool. There was, yes.
Thank you. Maybe Peter or Sam would like to talk about the Chinatown inexpensive buses and how they started up post 9/11, or actually a little before 9/11, and thrived, and then the feds came down and basically tried to dismantle it for people like Greyhound and so forth.
Ken is expert on this, so maybe Ken, you should answer that question.
Well, I mean, this is an area I've been studying and sort of looking at the Fujianese economic activity, and I think this is a really important part of our conversation today in shifting the narrative about Chinatown. I think that's part of what we've got going on here is that this incredible narrative about the decline of Chinatown, when actually we have a job incubator there, and the narrative of decline serves certain interests within the community, that we have to go in and rescue this, we have to change, we have to do redevelopment. But in reality, this strip along East Broadway and the lower east side of Chinatown has been generating jobs for 25 years now, and it's the center for this whole hub of ethnic restaurants that are Chinese restaurants all over the country. So, and the buses are a fascinating example of that, in that they are small businesses that have started up to serve very specific needs, moving people within the city, and then long distance as well. You've got a couple of dozen, or a dozen at least, long distance buses that mostly run restaurant workers. And this whole process there.
And college students.
And college students now, and they crossed over into the mainstream, and you go down there, and now there are bus stops everywhere. It's been fascinating to me to talk to folks in the community who want to ignore the presence of these buses, and in order to clean up Chinatown, are sort of encouraging the movement of these bus stops off the streets. And I stood out on the corner with some ticket ladies who were selling tickets to the buses, and one of them pulled out this wad of police summonses that she had received over the last week or two. All these pink, and she asked me, if I could translate some of these things. And they were court summonses. You know, she had missed like 2 months of court dates because she was selling tickets on the sidelines and on the sidewalks, and the cops were saying, "Well, you're impeding pedestrian traffic." But actually what they're doing is generating economic activity, and that's not just revitalizing and keeping Chinatown active, but it's built Sunset Park, and it's revitalizing Flushing and Sheepshead Bay, and it's also building this massive economic network all over the country. So, I mean, the buses are a really fascinating structure issue for the city to think about if you really wanted to support Chinatown and its long-term sustainability as a job, as an immigrant gateway, as an incubator of small businesses. Then you would think about how to create places for buses to stop. Instead of when the fire burned the shopping market there on the corner of Allen and East Broadway, instead of like racing in and having a hotel there, we should have had a bus depot. right? We could have, there have been many opportunities to create space for this kind of activity, but it doesn't meet the needs of those folks who want to turn Chinatown into a tourist destination to drive up real estate values. So I think this is a fascinating narrative, and just to be able to tell that story is so important. I'm glad you're thinking about that. Maybe Sam and Peter want to add to that.
I just want to add a quick, first of all, it's ironic that a robust bus network would not be good for tourism. You would think that that's exactly what they want. The plan to the plan to do 100% affordable housing at the Seward Park urban renewal area was going to be financed with a massive bus depot on the first floor. Now, whether or not that was a good idea, there is a way to do all of these things together and have a lot of affordable housing in the only place you could build without displacing new people and accommodate the thriving bus industry. It's just off the table. They took it to the city council member. She said absolutely not, and then it didn't happen.
Yeah. I'm afraid we've hit 6:30. Yeah. So it's amazing how this time has flown. It's been a very stimulating conversation. Great questions from the audience. Thank you so much to our panelists.